of, you know, me, very young reporter, saying to the head of the River Squad in Manchester, I know this case, and there's nothing on this tape that isn't already in the public domain. Wouldn't listen to that. Wrong voice. Wrong sex. It was senior police officers and crime correspondents discussing a missing figure that they cooked up between them. I think they were completely oblivious to the kind of biases they had.
Two people, Dick Holland and George Oldfield, had convinced themselves that this was the killer sending the communications, but they were only looking for positive aspects of the letters contained that fitted their conceptions. This correspondence has been the holy grail. I had the answer, I had the solution, I had the means to bring all this to the end.
Jefferson told me he submitted a formal report outlining his concerns about the taped letters and the fact they held no information that wasn't already publicly known. But clearly he was ignored.
Before, we know we'd been looking for a man, we didn't know where he came from. But now that we can localise the area, the view is now appreciably, as I'm sure you must agree.
Even though no survivor remembered hearing the Sunderland accent, and Zacharyson had raised concerns, Oldfield insisted on keeping the tape and letters at the centre of the investigation.
Meeting the Hunts turned into a personal vendetta for George Oldfield, who was working an 18-hour day, strained to control.
In August 1979, Oldfield fell seriously ill. He'd suffered a heart attack and went on sick leave for 5 months.